If you're a fan of the Creator's Game, this is the podcast for you. This is Off the Wing with Louis DeDonatis, all about the MCLA. Now, here's Louis.
On this episode of Off the Wing, it is your 2016 MCLA National Championship Primer. I break down every single game in the tournament, round by round, taking you all the way up to the National Championship, and I reveal to you who I believe the National Champion will be, as well as your player of the tournament. All that and more on the final edition of Off the Wing with Louis DeDonatis. And just as a reminder, remember, every game in the 2016 MCLA National Tournament can be streamed live on two different websites. LAX.TV is the first one, that's LAX.TV, and MCLA.US. The games can be streamed on either one. The LAX TV crew does an incredible job of putting the games together, streaming them for you. Different interactive features, you know, the ability to tweet at both the sideline reporter, the color commentator, the play-by-play guy. You can talk to all the commentators as the game is going live. They'll take your questions live. They'll answer them on the air. It's a very fan-friendly thing, and it's a cool thing for the players as well. I don't know how many times I've watched last year's national championship game, but it's probably well over 100. Instant replays, in-game analysis. You have color commentator Chris Malone, former coach of Arizona State University. He is probably the best in the business, the way he breaks down the game, you know, breaks down plays for you, shows you exactly what's going on, tells you what he thinks is going to happen next. It's a great crew that LAX TV has over there, led by Panchito Ojeda. They're going to be doing a great job broadcasting the tournament. Make sure you tune in and watch every game. Starting off now with the 1 seed Chapman playing a 16 seed Purdue. This is a team in Chapman that has gone undefeated throughout the season, but they are not without their blemishes. They lost Steve Caressel in an incident that I'm not going to get into. He's no longer on the team. He was a first-team All-Conference player a season ago, second-team All-American a season ago. He was an attackman, one of, if not their best players. He's no longer on the team. However, it didn't seem to affect him in their conference championship game against GCU. GCU is one of the best teams in the country. Chapman was able to beat them by one. That was a thriller. Came down to the final seconds. I believe Chapman won the game with 13 seconds left. They put in the game winner. They were down by four very late in that game. Went on a 5-0 run to win that. But again, a one goal victory. They also beat BYU by only one goal. So as great as Chapman has been, they're undefeated on the season. They are not an unbeatable team by any means. And this is something that I've said on many episodes of Off the Wing now. I said I don't think Chapman is going to go undefeated this season. I think they have to lose at least one game if they want to win the national championship. It's too late now. So either I'm wrong and they're winning the national championship, or I'm right. And because they didn't lose, they're going to lose a game that they probably shouldn't in the national tourney. So, you know, time will tell. I can tell you one thing. It's not going to be the first-round game. They're going to cruise past Purdue and into the second round. Chapman moves on in the first-round game. And in our next game, we have the number 2-seeded Cal Poly Mustangs and it's number 15 Southern Methodist University. Interesting thing here about SMU, they are 16-0 on the year. They have not lost. Cal Poly has only lost one time this whole entire season. You know, SMU coming in as the 15 seed is because they play in a very weak conference and they don't really have any wins under their belt that make you say wow. But the fact that they're undefeated, that's a pretty big thing to me. I don't know when the last time the 15 seed in the MCLA National Tournament was undefeated, but I would, you know, venture to guess that it hasn't happened very often. Also, here would be a fun fact for you. You know, I don't have a research team, so I don't know the exact number on this. But when do you think was the last time in the first round of the MCLA tourney you had a matchup of two teams with one loss between them? Yeah, I don't know the answer for that one either. Let's take a look now at Cal Poly, though, because they're the 2 seed in the tournament, and they are a team that I really like for a couple reasons. I believe defense wins championships. I'm a firm believer in that. Cal Poly probably has the best defense in the entire country. They have only given up double-digit goals against them one time this whole entire season. That came against GCU. They lost to them 10-9 at GCU, their lone loss on the year. And that also took GCU all of regulation and triple overtime to get to double digits. So you're talking about a team in Cal Poly where they are not giving up much. And that is the type of lacrosse, and that's the style of lacrosse that wins games come tournament time. Here's the scary thing to me about Cal Poly, however, is they're a very young team. And they have a new coach in Bobby Dabrio, who I think has done a great job in taking over for Mark Lee, an incredible job. Remember, Mark Lee was a great coach for them for a long time. Coach Dabrio has walked into a situation and just really made the most of it, doing an incredible job with that team. So they're a team that I love their style of lacrosse. I believe in the way they play. I like their system. And they're going to beat SMU. As good as SMU is, they're undefeated. They're going to get by SMU in the first round. How far they go, I'm really not sure, because I have to tell you, their youth really scares me. As a player at GCU, my first 3 years there, we didn't win the national championship. And we really didn't have a ton of success in the MCLA tourney especially. We only won one MCLA tournament game, and that was my freshman year. It was when we were playing Division II MCLA. It is very tough as a young team to go into the MCLA tourney and win games there. You're talking about the top 16 teams in the country, theoretically. Now, you can make the argument that maybe 14, 15, and 16 aren't part of the top 16, which I understand they get the automatic qualifier because they win their conference. But by and large, so let's say the top 13 teams in the country, right? So you're playing a high level of lacrosse. The intensity is ratcheted up. Every game has that much more importance. And I think as a young team, that can really get to you. However, Cal Poly does win their first round game against number 15 SMU. Number 14, Michigan State, with a record of 9-4 on the year, versus number 3 GCU, coming in at 10-4 on the year. Michigan State, I think you have to give that program and especially that head coach a lot of credit. If you are a lacrosse fan and if you really pay attention to the MLO or international lacrosse, you will certainly recognize the name Cam Holding. He is a great player, and he is also obviously clearly a great head coach for what he did with the Michigan State team this year. Michigan State was a team that coming into this year, I think there was a lot of uncertainty around them. I think if you would have told a lot of people within the MCLA that Michigan State would end up making the tournament, that would have been considered a win by just about everybody for Michigan State on the season. Taking all those great things I just said about Michigan State, I hate to say this, but they're not getting by GCU. I think this will be a rather easy game for GCU. I look at Michigan State, and they have 6 wins, 4 losses on the year. None of their wins were really particularly impressive. Their best win of the season was over Pittsburgh. And I look at their losses, and in particular their losses when they played good teams. Georgia Tech is the 4 seed in the tournament. They played Georgia Tech earlier this year, Sunday, March 6th, and they lost to Georgia Tech 11-5. Although a 6-goal loss to the number 2 team in the polls throughout the year, the number 4 seed now in the tournament, although it's not bad, I look at their other games, Virginia Tech, another good team, and I look at their game against Davenport, a good team in their own right. They lost both those games by 1 goals, but a quality loss, because that's what those would be considered. Their losses to Virginia Tech and Davenport are quality losses. You could say, so to say, they lost by 1 to 2 pretty good teams. There's a big difference between a quality loss and a win, and it takes a lot of guts to win those games, and that's the true sign of a good team. And GCU is heads and shoulders above Virginia Tech and Davenport. So while I did say a lot of really good things about Michigan State and what they did this year, I don't think they are good enough to get a win over the number 3 seed in the MCLA National Tourney. So I think their season comes to an end in the first round. But all in all, hey, give Michigan State a lot of credit. It was a pretty good year. But the defending champs move on, and they beat Michigan State in the first round. Number 13, California, versus number 4, Georgia Tech. California is coming in with a 10-6 record. Georgia Tech, remember, they're undefeated on the season, 14-0. And I have to address this. I have to get this out of the way before I even start to talk about the game. How much value do the polls, the regular season polls, even have? And the reason I ask this question is because Georgia Tech, throughout pretty much the entirety of the regular season, were ranked number 2 in the polls behind Chapman, who was number 1. Georgia Tech never lost, undefeated on the year. I understand they don't play in the best conference, the SELC, but it's far from the worst conference. They played the schedule. I don't want to say the schedule they were given, because this isn't the NFL where the league gives them a schedule, but being in that part of the country, in Georgia, you're not surrounded by a lot of great teams in the MCLA, right? So it can be very tough for a program like Georgia Tech to travel, especially working on the budget they're working on, and play some of the top teams, and play some of the games that probably would have propelled them to maybe taking the 1 seed over Chapman. But I have to wonder what went on in the room or I should say, what went on in the call, I would imagine it was a conference call, between the committee or the coaches, whoever selected the seeding for the national tournament. What was said to who made the case that Georgia Tech should go from being number two in the polls all year to number four in the national tournament? Because I, quite frankly, I don't understand it. And I think what it does is it just waters down the value of the regular season polls. What good did the polls do? What good did the polls do Georgia Tech? Did they do something in their SELC conference tournament to make you think, huh, you know, maybe they're not the two seed? I wouldn't say so, right? They won their conference tournament by beating Virginia Tech 12-6 in the finals. They beat Liberty the game before that 13-6. So what could have, where did they go wrong? Where did Georgia Tech as a program go wrong? I don't see it. I don't understand it. And I can tell you one thing. He's a classy guy, and he's also the president of the league, so he's not going to, you know, publicly maybe voice his opinion about it. But Ken Lovett cannot be happy. That much I can just about guarantee you. There is no way the head coach of Georgia Tech or any player, parent, assistant coach, whoever's affiliated, anybody within that program can be happy about where they're seated in the national tournament. But with that being said, they are playing number 13 Cal in the first round, and Georgia Tech is going to roll, I believe. I think they are very, very upset about what happened, obviously, as I already mentioned. And I think they take a lot of that frustration out on Cal. Remember, Georgia Tech, they might just have the best goalie in the country, Matthew Sommerfeld. That guy can play. They are a good defense. They are a good offense. And they are ready to unleash in the first round. They get by Cal. Number 12, Oregon State, coming into this first round matchup with a regular season record of 11-4 versus number 5, BYU, at 12-4. BYU, remember back now, the past 2 years, they have been upset in the first round. Both years, two devastating losses, I would say, for a perennial top program. Remember, it wasn't all that long ago that they won a national championship. I believe the year was 2011. That was the year, 2011. So it's been, you know, it's been 5 years since they last did it. But I think BYU this year is as dangerous as they have been since that last national championship season. You look at a team like BYU, and I think the first thing you look at is you have to look at the maturity of that team. They might be a young team in terms of freshman, sophomore, junior, senior, in terms of class, but they are not a young team in terms of their age. Remember, a lot of players on that team, because of the school they go to and the faith they believe in, they take mission trips after high school, either right after they graduate or a year after their first year into college. I'm not Mormon. I don't know the exact specifics of it. But to my knowledge, it's typically a two-year mission trip. So let's say, for example, you graduate high school and you're 18. You take your two-year mission trip. All of a sudden, you come back to BYU as a freshman. You're 20 years old. By the time you're a senior, you can be either 23 or 24 years old. And that's a huge advantage. I don't care what anybody says. When you turn 24 years old, you're a man. At 18 years old, you're not quite a man yet, right? So that's an advantage. You have 24-year-olds out there potentially playing against 18-year-olds. You know, that's a big difference to me. And even if they're not seniors, let's say BYU is a young team this year. Say their best players are sophomores. They're still 22 years old. So you're taking your sophomores, and they're at the maturity level of other teams' seniors. That's a big thing to me. Let's look at BYU and what they did this season. 10-4 on the year. And they really, throughout the regular season, to put it frank, I wasn't overly impressed with BYU. You know, their quality wins just were not there. They beat Arizona State 8-7, and I guess you can consider that a quality win. But they lost to GCU at their own place 12-4. They got crushed by GCU. An 8-goal loss in Utah at your own field. That's a bad loss. They lost to Colorado. They lost to Colorado State. So they really only had, out of the four, you know, quality opponents they played, they only had one win. And then all of a sudden, they enter the RMLC conference tournament, and everything turns around for them. They beat Colorado State 10-5. They beat Colorado 12-8. And, you know, it's like, hey, wow, BYU's back in business. I don't believe BYU goes three straight years with first-round losses. I have them beating Oregon State. I think Oregon State is a good team. I just don't think they are good enough to beat BYU. And so for that reason, I have BYU moving on in this one. Number 11, U of A, that is Arizona, versus number 6, Boston College. Arizona with a 7-5 record on the year. Boston College went 12-3. Boston College, the 6th seed in the tournament. You get a record of 12-3 on the year. I think I'm okay with that. I think they've earned that. I look at Boston College as the higher seed in this game, and I look, well, and I've spoken about this many times, I think Fogo, your face-off man, especially in tournament time, is an extremely critical possession. When you get into the tournament, when you get into the postseason, the game really does start to slow down. And I think maybe a lot of that has to do because the teams are a lot more even. You're no longer playing a team that you're significantly better than, and you can run and gun all day. So what that does is naturally that takes a lot of possessions out of the game. Let's say if you're an offense and you regularly get, let's say you get 40 possessions a game. In a postseason game, and I'm just throwing 40 out there as a number. I don't know what the average number of possessions is. But let's say in a regular season game, you get 40. I think in a postseason game, that number is going to get cut down anywhere between, 35, 34, 36, somewhere in that range. But what that does is that just ups the value of your faceoff man. So the more times you can start off with the ball after one team scores, in a 50-50 situation, which a faceoff truly is, the more times you can win that, and let's say you've got a top faceoff guy and he goes 75% in a game, so now instead of being in 50, a faceoff should theoretically be a 50-50, numbers game. If two teams have two great faceoff guys, instead of that number being at 50, you're now pushing that number to 75. And I think the higher that faceoff win percentage number goes, the higher your team's win percentage goes, probably, so to say, right? If that makes sense. I know I was kind of all over the map there. But when you look at Boston College, they have a guy in Griffin Carney. This was a guy I watched play live against Arizona State, and he went up against a pretty good faceoff guy in their own right, Zach Mathian. But Griffin Carney dominated him. Griffin Carney dominated just about everybody he played throughout the season. And so that's why in this game, I think it's going to be a very tight game, extremely tight. I remember back now, this is a rematch of a regular season game. U of A played Boston College earlier this season, March 5th, in Arizona, and U of A spanked them. Score was 16-5 in that game. No team in this matchup is beating the other team by 11 goals. U of A will not beat Boston College by 11 goals again. Boston College will not beat U of A by 11 goals. In fact, I have U of A winning this game, and here's why. I just said a lot of great things about Boston College and Griffin Carney and the job he can do and how important faceoffs are. But here's the difference to me for U of A. U of A did not make their conference tournament. Okay, let's remember that. U of A did not make their conference tournament. They still get a bid into the national tournament, and to me that speaks to how strong the SLC is as a conference. The fact that they don't even have to send a team to their own conference tournament, the team can still get into the national tournament. That speaks volumes of the SLC. But what does that mean for U of A now? U of A, the last time they played was April 16th. Their next game is going to be May 9th. That is 3 weeks off for them. And at this point in the season, when your body is breaking down, when you're fighting injuries, when you're fighting complacency, every game now is a grind. When you can have a three-week vacation, by them missing the conference tournament, that may have just been a huge blessing in disguise for that program. I think they get by Boston College in the first round, and I look at the play of goalie Tanner Canego. He's a senior. He doesn't care. If he wins a national championship, he does not care that his team did not make the conference tournament. None of that matters. Do they have 4 wins left in them? I don't think they have 4, but I think they have at least 1, and I think they beat Boston College in the first round. Number 10, UC Santa Barbara versus number 7, Colorado. Teams had identical records on the year. UCSB was 10-5, Colorado was 10-5, and both teams played in the two top conferences in the country. UCSB coming out of the SLC, Colorado coming out of the RMLC. So I think you have 2 pretty evenly matched teams, which is what you really want to have in the 10-7 matchup. I bashed the seeding committee earlier by dropping Georgia Tech from 2-4, but I think overall, all in all, I think they did a pretty good job despite that blunder. And I think this could be a close game. Maybe I think you have 2 of the best coaches in the MCLA. In fact, in my second ever episode of Off the Wing, I believe it was, I received a question: who do you have as the top top five coaches in the MCLA. And Coach Galvin, I had him up there. I think Coach Galvin is, you know, quite possibly as good a coach as any. I think you look at the job he's able to do with that team each and every year. Every single year they are in contention. Every single year it seems like they are there at the end of the dance. They're there when it matters most. And they always seem to peak at the right time. They play great defense. They great offense. They're a great transition team. They just do a lot of things really well. And then you look at UCSB and Coach Mike Allen. He's a great coach in his own right. Coming off a very, let's say, a terrible year by UCSB standards. They were awful last year. He's able to get his team to bounce back this season, and he's able to get his team into the national tournament. I think UCSB is another team where if at the beginning of the season you told them and you told everybody within the MCLA that they would be playing in the national tournament, I think they would have taken that. With that being said, I don't think they're good enough to beat Colorado, although I think I like their goalie, Peter Bryden. He played a big part. This is, you take note of this, he played a big part in their first game against Colorado. He had 26 saves in that game, okay? 26 saves when UCSB played Colorado the first time. It was a 14-10 win. So you cannot understate that. With that being said, I think a lot of times you can figure out a goalie. And here's another interesting thing to point out about goalies. Look at a lot of the top goalies in the NCAA or the MCLA even. They come in their freshman years or the first year of their starters, and they really light it up. Their save percentage is 72, 75, something just crazy. Maybe not that high, but you get what I'm saying. Throughout their career, their save percentage slowly but surely just kind of dips just a little bit, maybe 2% every year, whatever the case may be. But teams start to figure you out as a goalie. Goalies have areas where they're a lot better at saving the ball than others. You know, maybe one goalie, his natural tendency is to drop on shots. So he's going to be a lot better saving shots that are low rather than shots that are high, right, naturally. And so, you know, this guy for UCSB, he's a rookie. Peter Bryden, he was pretty good this year, but as time goes on, he might be able to fade. I just felt the need to point that out. But what I'm also trying to say is your second matchup against a goalie that you already played in the regular season, I believe that favors the offense because I think they have a better chance of figuring out the goalie in this one. So with that being said, I think Colorado beats UCSB in this first-round game and moves on to the second round. Number 9 Arizona State versus number 8 Colorado State. The 9-8 matchup, it's supposed to be on paper the tightest matchup of every game played in the first round. And I think this first round matchup really does have the potential to be just that, the tightest game played in the entire first round, which is what it should be going by the numbers. This is also a regular season rematch. Remember, in the regular season, Arizona State was supposed to take a trip to Colorado to play both Colorado and Colorado State a lot earlier than they eventually did. Their first trip got postponed because of a snowstorm, so unfortunately they had to travel out in mid-April. They played Colorado State on April 13th, and they beat CSU the first time 7-6. That was, up to that point, I would say that was ASU's, their signature win at that point in the season. I would consider it, sorry, I misspoke. That was a big win for CSU. I would not call that their signature win. I think their signature win was probably over Grand Canyon, a game in Phoenix. But it was a big win for CSU over Arizona State. They went 10-3 on the year. They had only lost one game all season long prior to that, you know, to U of A. And I think they were really rolling. Now, they were 10-1 after they beat ASU. They would go on to lose their final two games of the year to Colorado and to BYU. But CSU is a good team. You know, no two ways about it. They are a team that was really rebounding after last year. Remember, they lost their head coach, Alex Smith. Alex Smith is one of the greatest coaches in MCLA history. They went from Coach Alex Smith to Coach Ted Feifeld, and Coach Feifeld stepped right in and did a remarkable job. He led his team to the MCLA National Tourney and to a game against Arizona State in the first round of the tourney. Arizona State now 7-6 on the year, and that's not the typical record you would see out of the 8 seed in the national tournament. I think typically you would see a probably a lot better record. Sorry, out of your nine seed, you know, and I'm not sure when the last time the nine seed in the national tournament came in with a record of 7-6. That's only one game above 500. And if you look at their, you know, their regular season record and the games they played, I think they had a great win against U of A, beating them 9-5. Great win against Colorado, beating them 12-9. But other than that, I look up and down their schedule. And I'm not that all that impressed. And with that being said, I think in this game, typically when you play a very similar team in the regular season, I would tend to favor the team that lost the first time. I would tend to favor them in the rematch of that game. I would tend to say, you know, Arizona State would this game. However, this time I'm not going to do that. I think CSU beats ASU twice and moves on to the second round of the MCLA National Tourney, and that is a wrap for the first round. The teams I have moving on now. Chapman will play CSU in the second round. Georgia Tech plays BYU in the second round. Cal Poly plays Colorado. And GCU plays U of A in the second round of the national tournament. All right, the number one seeded Chapman Panthers taking on the number eight seeded Colorado State Rams. This is a game, I'm just going to give you my prediction early. I have Chapman winning this one. I think CSU is a very good team, but a rookie head coach and Coach Feidfeld, and I just think the Chapman Panthers, with all things considered, with the home field advantage playing right in their backyard, I don't see Chapman only, you know, going undefeated throughout the season and then only winning one game in the national tournament. You know, that's just very hard for me to imagine. Although I do believe Chapman has their flaws and their blemishes, I think they're good enough to beat Colorado State, and I think they will do that. And hey, let's look back on this great season for Colorado State, right? As I mentioned earlier, Colorado State didn't even make the tournament last year. So they go from being a team that wasn't even in the tournament to all of a sudden making the Elite Eight. They were one of the final eight teams standing, which is where, and give the people that seeded this tournament, give them credit again. They had the eight seed as one of the final eight teams standing. That's, you know, on paper where you put them. And they projected that accurately, I would say. Obviously, this is just my pick, but I believe this is what will happen. But I have Chapman getting into the Final Four, beating CSU. Great season for CSU, but just not quite enough to get past the number one team in the country. And the next second round game now is number four Georgia Tech against number five BYU. Remember, Georgia Tech would beat California to get to this point. BYU would beat Oregon State to get to this point. And here's where it gets interesting. I think in their first round game, Georgia Tech is going to come out and blow out California. I think they are very frustrated with the four seed, rightfully so, and I think they're going to take out a lot of their frustration. I believe BYU is going to beat Oregon State pretty handily. Here is what scares me now about Georgia Tech. I think they're a great team. I think they have a great coach. I believe they should have been the two seed in this tournament, not the four seed. I already vented about that. And this is something that I have the same concerns for Chapman over. However, I think Chapman moves on in the second round, and I don't think Georgia Tech does. Here's why. I have BYU winning this game, actually. What scares me, and I talked about it a couple times throughout the regular season, is these teams that enter the national tournament undefeated. As a guy who played for the national champions last year, we took a loss in the regular season, and it made all the difference in the world for us. So, you know, maybe if I was a player on the Colorado State team a couple years ago that went undefeated and won the national tournament, maybe I'd be singing a different tune, and maybe I would have Chapman winning the whole entire thing because they're undefeated and they're the number one team. But because that, you know, you're a victim of your experiences, so to say. So maybe if we had beat BYU and we had gone on to win the whole thing, maybe my view on this would be different. But because of the circumstances, it's not. And I'm a firm believer that it is just extremely hard to go undefeated, go the whole way, and give that CSU team, the last team to go undefeated and win it all, give them a lot of credit. Because you've got to be, that's a perfect season, right? We weren't perfect last year, but we finished as the champs. And I just don't think Chapman or Georgia Tech, the two, other than SMU, the two undefeated teams, in the tournament. I just don't think they are as good as that CSU team that was the last to do it. And I think this bites Georgia Tech a little bit earlier than it bites Chapman. And I don't think Georgia Tech gets by BYU. I think BYU is really peaking at the right time, and I think that's something you look for at this point in the season. You're talking about the Elite Eight now. I think you're looking for the teams playing their best ball. And BYU, as evidenced by their conference tournament, they are playing their best lacrosse now. And they're a team, they're dangerous as anybody. They are older than anybody. They are more mature than anybody. They are a perennially great program. And I'm sorry for Georgia Tech, but I think their storybook season, so to say, comes to an end to BYU. BYU moves on to the Final Four, beating Georgia Tech. Number two, your Cal Poly Mustangs versus number seven, CU Buffs. This is tough. This is a very tough game. On paper, you've got to give the edge to Cal Poly. I spoke when I was breaking down Cal Poly's first-round matchup against SMU. I spoke to how dangerous I believe Cal Poly is because they are a defensive-minded team. I love their style of play. I think their style of play works wonders for you in the playoffs, in tournament games where the games slow down and you really have to rely on your defense to get stops. I understand that. I get all that. But there's just something about Colorado and the way they play in the postseason, particularly the national tournament. We played Colorado last year in the regular season at CU. We beat them 18-15. We played them in the national tournament, the national championship game, and we saw a significantly better team. We only beat them 9-8. When the stage is the biggest, that is when Colorado plays their best, and I think they had a real wake-up call in the RMLC tournament by not winning that tourney. I think going into the RMLC tourney, they thought they were going to win it. They did not get that done, and I think that wake-up call was probably the worst thing that could have happened to Cal Poly. Safe to say, I think Cal Poly is a great team. I like Cal Poly. I like Coach Debrio. I like Sean Pill. Like I said, though, I just think they're young, and it's very hard for a young, inexperienced team to come into this thing and to win this thing. And I think in this matchup, I really look at the matchup of coaches. I'm a huge fan of Coach Debrio. I'm a bigger fan of Coach Galvin. He's been there. He's done that. And I think he has, you know, just enough left in him, just enough left in the CU team to get a big win and to move on to the Final Four. I have Colorado beating Cal Poly. Okay, now the last matchup of the Elite Eight, the last matchup to decide who goes to the Final Four. This is a matchup between two in-conference foes, SLC conference foes, Grand Canyon University and the U of A Wildcats, or the Lax Cats, as they like to call themselves. This is also a regular season rematch. These teams both play in the SLC South. Two teams very familiar with each other, to say the least. One of the best rivalries in all of the MCLA. And remember back to that first matchup between the two teams. GCU went into Tucson and they won by one. One goal. It was an 11-10 victory for GCU. Like I've said before, in this type of game, typically when you have two pretty similar teams, pretty evenly matched teams, I would tend to go with the loser of the first matchup and the second matchup. However, once again, call me a homer. That's okay. I don't care. I have GCU getting by U of A. I think playing in Tucson had a lot to do with that one goal difference between the two in the first meeting. Give Tucson credit, give U of A credit, give their fans credit. It's a very tough place to play. They make it hard on you. I think that probably had a little bit to do with it. Also, GCU drove up the day of the game. That's a two-hour drive. So you're sitting on the bus for 2 hours before you have to start your warm-ups and play against one of the top teams in the MCLA. And the reality is what I'm doing right now is I'm making excuses for a game that GCU won. I'm just making excuses for why they didn't win by more. I think GCU is the better team. I think they've been there before. Sorry, I don't think they have been there before. I know they've been there before. U of A has not been here in a long time, especially with this group of players. While I think U of A is good enough to upset Boston College in the first round, I don't think they have enough in them to take down the defending champs, and for that reason, I have GCU moving on to the Final Four. And here's where it really starts to get fun. We are now in the Final Four. These are the two games now that decides who will play in the national championship, but I'm telling you things you already know. Let's look at the first matchup now. I want to look at the number one team in the country, the Chapman Panthers, and I want to look at the team they're going to be playing in this matchup, number five, BYU. Chapman, now remember, the first two rounds of the national tourney will be held at Cal Irvine, one of those It's not going to be at Chapman's actual field. This will be the first game for Chapman at their actual field. This game will be at Ernie Chapman Stadium. So the home field advantage, I hate to keep referencing back to my own team, but last year we played Chapman in the same exact round. We played them in the Final Four at Chapman. They do have a home field advantage, make no doubt about it. Luckily, we came out to start that game on fire, 8-2. Chapman came back a little bit to make it tight. We still ended up winning. I believe the final score was 11-8, although I could be wrong. Chapman will have a home field advantage, no doubt about it. They are the number one team in the country. On paper, if this is the matchup that ends up coming to fruition, they will be heavily favored, I believe, against BYU. However, and I've mentioned this throughout the year, and I think this is finally when it comes back to bite Chapman. I believe they are playing a very experienced team in BYU. Although they might be young on paper, they have a lot of older players on that team. I think Chapman is a great team. I think they might even be a better team than BYU, but I don't think they're going to be the better team on this day. I have the Chapman Panthers. You know, they're undefeated. They're perfect. They're, their storybook season. I have it coming to an end in the Final Four on their very own field against BYU. Just a fun fact for you. This will be the third straight year now that Chapman has hosted the national championship. The national tournament and the national championship. How many games do you think they've won on their own field of Ernie Chapman Stadium? Zero. Okay, so it wasn't, although it may be an advantage, it wasn't too much of an advantage the first 2 years. They lost to ASU the first year, they lost to GCU the second year, they're going to lose to BYU the third year, I believe. As great as Chapman is, I just don't have them getting by BYU. Also, remember earlier in this podcast, I mentioned Chapman's blemishes. I said they were a great team, they were a very good team, but by no means were they unbeatable. And one of the reasons why I said that, and I referenced their win to BYU earlier in the season, but they only beat them by one. You learn more from your losses than your wins. That is something that I have said over and over, and that favors BYU in this matchup. 5-1 and moves on to the national championship game. And in our second and final four game, our last game to decide who goes to the national championship, number 3, GCU against number 7, Colorado. Oh, by the way, a rematch of last year's national championship game. Oh, by the way, again, a rematch of a regular season matchup earlier this year in which GCU beat Colorado by one goal. If you remember back to that first matchup, that was a game on the SLC channel. It was broadcast live. A lot of people watched it. I actually did the sideline reporting for that game. Matt Holman and Chris Malone called it as the color commentator and the play-by-play analysts, whatever you want to call them. That was a great game. GCU was up by a lot in the fourth quarter. I want to say they were up by 7 goals, I believe, going into that fourth quarter. Colorado came all the way back. They took the lead with not a lot of time left. GCU would go on to score 2 more goals and win the game by 1. It was arguably the best game in the regular season so far, and we are lucky enough to, in Louis DiDonatis' fantasy world, get a rematch of it in the Final Four of the MCLA National Tournament. Again, what's remarkable about this, and I think this really speaks to the level of parity in the MCLA, I have said this multiple times now, you have a lot of rematches of one-goal games. A lot of teams throughout the regular season, teams play one another, and you have a lot of tight games, one-goal games. You have a lot of rematches of those in the national tournament, which makes for a great tournament. Typically, I would pick the loser to win this game. However, I look at Colorado, as great as they are come tournament time, as great as they have been this year and all the things they've been able to do, but I just look at GCU and I just think they're a better team, and here's why. I can't help but think back to that first matchup between the two teams. GCU, through the first 3 quarters, was just dominating them, really dominating Colorado. Colorado looked awful, to put it lightly. Keep in mind, it was their first game of the year. I get that. But GCU looked like the significantly better team through the first 3 quarters. And on the other side of the coin, you could say that, well, look at the fourth quarter. Colorado looked like it was a significantly better team, which I get. I understand. I just think at the end of the day, GCU, this year's team, I think this year's GCU team is better than this year's Colorado team for sure. And I think it's going to be a tight game. I think it could be another one goal win. And maybe, you know, I'm just extremely biased, and that's why I'm picking GCU. I don't know. On paper, GCU is certainly favored to win. They're the 3 seed. Colorado's the 7. Could this go either way? Yeah, I think you can make that argument. But I think at the end of the day, GCU probably just has a little too much firepower on offense. And I think defensively, you are going to see a much better version of Grand Canyon in the postseason than you saw in the regular season. They will be the most well-prepared team in this tournament, that I can assure you of. Their defensive coordinator, Coach Jeff Guy, he's a Princeton guy. He coached at Princeton. He's ran his own programs at the D2, the D3 level. He might be the most well-kept secret in the whole MCLA. He will know every set that Colorado will be running, just as we did last year when we held them to 8 goals. He will have that team figured out. Their players will know where to be, and I think that will be the difference in the Final Four for GCU. I believe they move on to the national championship game for the second year in a row, where they will take on BYU, the 3 seed versus the 5 seed in the national championship. Number 3, Grand Canyon University. Number 5, Brigham Young University. And first, I just want to touch on this matchup's history for a little bit. Throughout my career at GCU, we played BYU a couple times. I believe it was 3 times. We never beat BYU in my tenure there. It is something that I would certainly love to take back. But at the end of the day, you know, it is what it is. You can't have any regrets, right? BYU is, I keep speaking about the age difference. I understand that, but BYU is a very tough team. They play a tough physical style of lacrosse. BYU turns the middle of the field into a war zone. They have one of the best rides in the MCLA. They have perennially for years. They have one of the best clears in the MCLA. You go from box to box, and that is where BYU really tries to crush you and really break your spirit. You can play 6-on-6 defense great against BYU for a couple of minutes. You can, you know, they can miss a couple shots. You can force turnovers. But it is a very hard thing to clear the ball against BYU. In particular, that really hurt us in our second matchup against BYU. This was all the way back in 2013. We played BYU in the regular season. They came to us. Nobody knew about us at the time. I'm not even sure if we were ranked at the time. We played them to a 1-goal game at GCU. They only beat us by 1. Going in to our national tournament game against BYU, a lot of people had us winning that game. We had just beaten Arizona State at the end of the regular season. ASU was the number 3 team in the country at the time. That was really our signature win. We felt very good about ourselves. We were a young team at the time. We didn't have too many great seniors, really too many even great juniors, I don't believe. We were a very extremely young team, but we felt like we were going to beat BYU. BYU broke our spirit very early in that game. We played defense almost the whole entire first half. We could not clear the ball against BYU. Their ride was relentless. They came out and they played their best ball when they needed to. BYU is a tough opponent. I say all that despite GCU going into BYU earlier this year and beating BYU 12-4. That was, in my mind, probably the biggest victory of GCU's season, and also probably BYU's most embarrassing loss. BYU is not a team that gets beat by 8 goals very often, to say the least. BYU is a perennial powerhouse, and they are just a great MCLA program. They have been for a very long time. They are a very proud program, and they have the right to be. They have earned that. In the national championship game now, this one could really, if this is what it comes down to, which I believe it will, I think you'll have the 3 playing the 5, GCU, BYU. You can almost make the argument that you could flip a coin. Despite GCU beating BYU by 8 goals earlier in the year, I think these are 2 very evenly matched teams. BYU is playing their best lacrosse of the season right now. GCU's last game was a game in which they lost to Chapman in the SLC championship game by 1 goal, and in particular the last 5 minutes they really fell apart. Chapman went on a 5-0 run to win that game. You can make the argument that that was the best thing to happen to GCU the last 5 minutes of that game. Maybe that's what they needed, one last wake-up call in a season full of wake-up calls for GCU. Maybe they needed just one more. I don't know. You can look at this game a number of different ways. You can break it down however you'd like. I have GCU winning this game. I have GCU winning the national championship despite everything that GCU went through. A very frustrating year for a lot of people at GCU. The first game of the year, you start off with a loss to Utah Valley. They lost to Boston College. They lost a lot of games. They probably shouldn't have. They lost to Colorado State. They lost to Chapman in a game that they certainly should have won. But I think GCU is able to put together their best 16 quarters of the season, and I think they're able to win this thing. And I think, in particular, they're the best four quarters of the season against BYU. I just spoke about how well prepared they will be under Coach Guy, and you cannot understate that. Am I a homer? Maybe so. Do I have a bias? Absolutely. Does that hurt the podcast? Maybe it does, because maybe you knew at the very beginning of this I was going to pick GCU. I don't know. You can call me a homer. You can call me whatever you'd like, but at the end of the day, if you don't think GCU is as dangerous as any other team in this tournament, I can call you crazy. They are a team as talented as any other and as well coached as any other, and I believe that is what gets them over the edge and propels them to becoming national champions. Grand Canyon University repeats back-to-back, two straight years. Book it. That was my last ever episode of Off the Wing with Louis DiDonatis. It was my pleasure doing this throughout the course of the season. I love you. I love the fans. I will see you in Orange County. I will be broadcasting the national tournament. I'm not sure exactly what my role will be yet. I know I'll be color commentating. I'll be sideline reporting. Remember, tune in, lax.tv, lax.tv, mcla.us, mcla.us. Just to repeat that if you don't know how to spell it. make sure you're watching. It's going to be a great year. It was a great year. It's going to be a great tournament. You will not want to miss it. And with that, I am officially signing off. Sayonara.